Good evening. Just a reminder, if you have a cell phone, if you could turn it off, we'll put it on silent so it doesn't disturb tonight's message. If we could bow for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you once again that we can gather together here in peace and safety, Lord, in the building that you provided for us. And we thank you, Lord, for all your faithfulness to us, Lord, and your grace and mercy, which is renewed every day. We thank you, Father, for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross so that through faith in him, we can have a healed relationship with you and all the blessings that go along with salvation, Lord. Thank you for preserving your word. And thank you for making a plan for us, Lord, that we can carry out in this world. I pray, Father, for Pastor as he brings forth the message tonight. I pray you just speak through him by the power of your Spirit. And I pray also, Father, that our hearts would be open, Lord, to receive the message, Lord, that we could get our portion for the day. I pray all that we do will bring glory and honor to your Son, Jesus, Lord. In his name we pray. Amen. If we could stand and praise the Lord.
My time has come, still my praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore.
Seed of Israel's race, he ransomed from the
Amen. You may be seated. Tonight's announcements. Tomorrow night is Pastor's Prayer and Praise Night. That'll be in the Fellowship Hall at 7 p.m. All are welcome to attend. And this coming Friday, there will be service at 7 p.m. And this Sunday will be the Lord's Supper. As customary here, we celebrate the Lord's Supper every first Sunday of the month. And November is coming to a close. With that said, children and teachers can be dismissed to class. And now it's my honor and privilege to introduce our pastor tonight, Pastor John Ritchie.
Thanks. Hello, folks. How you doing? Take your Bible, turn to Job chapter 1. I'm going to begin in the book of Job chapter 1 tonight. And we're going to continue looking at how Satan attacks believers with undeserved suffering. But before we get into it, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, tonight, we are grateful and thankful to have this time and this opportunity to gather with your people around the Word of God into the name of our risen Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And tonight, Father, I pray that you would challenge our hearts as we study your Word, that we would continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. And I pray that I could speak with humility and grace, wisdom, conviction, and passion. Father, I ask that I could speak with the authority that your word deserves and that I could take the knowledge you've given me on this subject and make it clear and accurate and understandable, that your people might not only hear the word but become doers of the word, that they might be blessed. And if there be anyone tonight, Lord, within the sound of my voice, or in the future through technology over the live stream tonight, that hears this message and is not saved, my prayer is that you would convict them of their sin and of their need of Jesus Christ as their Savior, that they might believe upon him and receive the forgiveness of sins and eternal life through faith in his name. And I ask this all now and all your blessing. Give each one of us what we need tonight. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And amen and amen. Okay, we're going to continue tonight looking at, under the conflict of the ages, Satan's offensive strategy of his attacks of undeserved suffering upon believers. And just give me a second. Get a little water. We want to note very importantly that God uses suffering to grow us. When we go through suffering and testing and adversity, it's an opportunity for us to grow, to trust God, to learn to depend upon his word and his promises, and to experience his faithfulness and his power that sustains us and brings us through, because his grace is always sufficient. And Satan uses undeserved suffering to hinder the spiritual advance of growing believers. Most of the suffering that many believers go through is simply deserved suffering. It's not from Satan, it's because of their bad decisions. They're just reaping what they sowed because they made bad decisions, poor judgments, got involved in things and sinful patterns of behavior that they shouldn't have been involved with, or people they shouldn't have been involved with, and they create some self-induced misery for themselves. That's deserved suffering. That is not undeserved suffering, which God allows to glorify him. But like any other suffering, if we repent and we trust him, God can take our bad decisions and turn them into what? Blessings. And he can use that to teach us and grow us and mature us, because that's his matchless love and what? Grace in all things. Undeserved suffering is a great opportunity to glorify God. If you're a believer and you're taking your spiritual walk seriously, then you're growing. And because you're growing, Satan's minions, not Satan himself, because you've got to go really far in the spiritual life. We'll look at a man tonight who did. To reach great heights of spiritual maturity before Satan takes notice of you. I mean, he knew Paul, he knew the apostles, he knew certain people in the Bible, Moses and Daniel and definitely Job, okay, and others, and he's known others throughout church history that are not named in the Bible, the saints of the ages. And he would attack them because they became witnesses for Christ, because they became a great level of spiritual growth. But for the normal, everyday growing believer, we experience undeserved suffering many times. God allows it because Satan's minions see that we're advancing and see that we have the potential to have an impact against what? The kingdom of darkness. Therefore, his minions will attack us to try to hinder our spiritual advance, to nullify our spiritual growth. And God allows it because God is going to use Satan's evil for good. And the good that's going to come out of it is God allows the suffering that's undeserved because it's an opportunity for us to grow, to trust God, to see God's faithfulness, to experience God's power and grace until he delivers us so we can handle any circumstance of life. This is how he matures us. And we talked a lot about this on Sunday morning if you were here. If you weren't, I would really suggest go online and get the message or pick up the CD. Okay, now here we come tonight, and we're going to look at Job. And in Job's life, we see a man who reached great heights of spiritual maturity. In fact, he was the greatest man on earth at his time. And because he reached these tremendous heights of spiritual maturity, which very, very few believers will reach, he became evidence against Satan in Satan's appeal trial. And God presented Job as evidence against Satan, as a witness against Satan. And Satan had the right now to cross-examine, just like a prosecuting attorney would do in a trial. God as the prosecuting attorney presents evidence against Satan. Satan as his own defense attorney has the right to cross-examine who? Job, okay? Remember, Satan's already been sentenced to the lake of fire, but it hasn't been executed yet. He's been given a chance in human history to prove his point that he can be like what? God. Okay. And one of Satan's first and greatest arguments against God is this, and we'll see it tonight. Men will only worship you, God, and men will only serve God because God blesses them. That's one of Satan's main arguments. Men will only worship and serve God because of what God gives them. Because God blesses them. And Satan will argue that if men lose the blessings, if God takes away the blessings, and if they consider their suffering to be unjust and unfair, then men will forsake God and curse God. That's Satan's argument, okay? Now you have to remember, Satan had everything he needed when he was created. Everything was provided for him. He was given rank, honor, privilege, and blessings by God. He was the anointed cherub that covereth what? The throne of God. He had the highest rank, the highest authority, the highest privilege. The greatest abilities were given to him and talents, but he did not want to accept his position and submit to the authority of God. He didn't want to give God his due rights. But he saw God and he saw heaven from the inside out. He saw it all face to face, yet he rebelled against the Creator. He did not give the Creator, God, his due worship. And Satan rejected God's authority and God's sovereign rights as Creator. And God can rule because God alone is qualified. And God can rule because it's his right as what? The Creator. He created it. He can do what he wants with his creation. And if we look through the Old Testament, we're going to see tremendous men like Moses and David and Daniel or Job, we're going to look at in a moment, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. And we'll see that, these are just to name a few, these men went through intense suffering, undeserved suffering. But it did not turn them into miserable, whining, emotional, depressed wrecks. They had their moments of weakness, they had their moments of discouragement, but they recovered and regrouped and they learned to depend on God and on the doctrine of the Word of God that they had stored, what? Here in their soul, and they handled the undeserved suffering until God removed it. And whatever God does not remove from our life, whatever He leaves in our life, He intends that we bear it. If you pray and ask God to take something away, and you keep praying and ask Him to take it away, and He doesn't take it away, it's because He wants you to what? Handle it. He's not going to get you through it by removing it. He's going to take you what? Through it, moment by moment, day by day, hour by hour, week by week, month by month, whatever it takes. And He's going to give you the grace and the strength to be able to face it with courage and trust Him and handle it until He what? Brings you out. Because that's how you grow. If God just snapped His fingers every time you had a problem and fixed it immediately, you'd never grow. You'd never learn to what? Trust Him and depend on Him and walk with Him. Okay, so we see that there are men who suffered greatly from the Old Testament and in the New Testament, and they did not fall to pieces. They were human, they had their moments, but they did not crumble. So we understand it is possible to trust God and to worship Him and serve Him and still praise Him, and I will even say this, and to rejoice in Him even in the midst of horrible suffering. Because we have evidence from the Scriptures. We also have evidence from human history. You know, the Apostle Paul was in a Roman prison when he wrote Philippians 4:4. A dark, damp, cold, rat-infested prison where he was chained and where he had to have comradeship with common, ordinary criminals, rapists, murderers, thieves. Okay? Where the food was terrible, where he was alone and forsaken by all. And yet as he writes Philippians, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. He's triumphant. He is so focused on Christ and understanding who God is and His position in Christ and the grace of God and the power of Jesus Christ made available to him, that he knows he's getting an opportunity as he's being tested with undeserved suffering to glorify God. And he's not concerned about getting the best of everything in this life. He is concerned that he has a testimony that he can take into the eternal life that's coming. That's his concern. And as we grow as Christians, we must grow out of the baby stage of always being concerned about our circumstance and how they affect us. And begin to understand that God is in control and He's got me in this circumstance because He wants to use it to glorify Him and to equip me to rule and reign with Him for all eternity, to make something out of me. And rather than getting down, you know, some folks, when they go through trouble, do you ever notice folks that you can tell it's on their face? They got a problem, you know it, because their whole countenance changes. You know what the Lord said in Matthew? He said, when you fast, in other words, when you're going through sacrifice, don't walk around with your head hanging down and, you know, letting everybody know that you're what? Going through fasting and sacrifice and self-denial and some physical suffering of hunger. He said what? Anoint yourself. Put your best clothes on. Put a smile on your face and say, praise the Lord. See, that's the step of spiritual growth. That's the big step of spiritual growth. And you and I have to decide, who do we want to be? Do we want to be the Christian that every time there's a problem in our life, we're going to put on the frown, our countenance is going to change, We're going to walk around down in the dumps, all discouraged and depressed, because after all, God is not God anymore. We have a problem now. Therefore, God is not God anymore. His promises don't mean anything anymore. And woe is us. Or are we going to say, you know what? God is God. He's in control. His promises are true. This ain't easy, but you know what? He's allowed it, so he's got a way out of it for me. And I'm going to trust him. And more than trust him, I'm not just going to grit my teeth and clench my fists until I get through it. You know, because we can do that too. Some of us are tough and we'll just, I'll hang in until I get through it. Others of us will just go, oh, woe is me. Poke, poke, poke. Right? Pity party. But how about doing this? Why not do like Paul said? Why not begin to praise God? If I got a burden and a problem and I'm suffering something, is not God still God? Anybody? Does your problem change the fact of who God is? Does your problem change the promises that he promised to take care of you and get you through it and provide everything you need and work it out for good? Does it? No. So why not? Well, you say, well, when I get through it and he gets me out of it, I'll praise him. No. Of course you'll praise him when it's done. Every one of us can look back and say, thank you, Lord, for getting me through that. But how did you act when you were in the middle of it? How did you act while you were going through it? Did you handle it in a way that glorified God, where you applied his word so that you could grow up spiritually and be a testimony against Satan? You know, Satan hates it when you're going through suffering and you're still serving God faithfully and you're still praising God and you still got a smile on your face and you're still trusting him. You may have a burden in your heart and your heart may be heavy, but you resist the devil's attacks of discouragement and depression and anxiety, and you decide God is still God and his word is still true and I'm coming through and I'm going to praise him now. Even though I don't have the victory yet, I don't see it, I'm praising him right now, because victory is what? Mine in Christ. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord will deliver him out of them what? All. This is how God wants us to respond to suffering. Okay. These men had spiritual strength from believing God's word to lift the shield of faith and the courage to face the adversity and hang in there until God brought them through. And they depended on the word that they had put here in their what soul. And of course, Satan's second argument is this. Everybody's got their price. People will only remain faithful to the Lord if God is offering enough to them. Wasn't that Satan's argument with Jesus when he took him to the mountain? He said, hey, look, bow down and worship me. Because see all this, all the kingdoms, they're mine. And if you'll worship me now, I'll what? Give them to you. What was his argument? Hey, everybody's got their price. If the devil offers you enough, will you curse God? Will you turn away from God? Let's look at a man named Job. Job chapter 1. Job chapter 1, look at verse number 1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was perfect, and perfect doesn't mean sinless, it means he was what? Complete. He had reached spiritual completeness. He was a spiritually mature man. Of great spiritual what? Maturity. He had reached great heights of spiritual what? Growth. Okay, where very few have gone. And he was upright. He was a man of integrity and honesty, who did right. And one that feared God, he reverenced God, and he eschewed evil. To eschew evil means he turned from evil. And so Job is a wonderful example of a witness that God presents against Satan. Now remember, you and I can suffer undeserved suffering when Satan's minions attack us because they see us growing. But every time we're under undeserved suffering, it's not Satan, unless you have grown to a great height of spiritual maturity. Satan himself takes personal interest only in those who become evidence against him. Now if you keep growing, and you walk with God seriously, and you take up your cross and die to self and follow Him, and that's the goal of your life, well, you may arrive someday at that place. You say, well, I don't want to go through the suffering. Well, that's, listen, if you get to that point, you will consider it an honor to suffer for the Lord. Because at that point, you're equipped and ready, and you've grown enough. So right now, you can't even think about something like that, so you know you're quite a ways away from where what? Where Job was. But let's keep growing. We may never get to the level Job get to, but let's keep growing, because the Lord will definitely reward us as we trust Him in whatever we have to go through. Let's keep reading. And there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters, 10 children. His substance was 7,000 sheep and 3,000 camels and 500 yoke of oxen and 500 she-asses, donkeys, and a very great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men of the East. So now, Job is a very wealthy man, and God has prospered him immensely. He was a millionaire many times over, okay? And God has no problem giving his saints money if they can what? Handle it without it destroying them, and use it to what? Further his what? Kingdom, and help others. There's no problem. Many people he can't give money to because he knows it'll destroy them and they'll be selfish with it. Okay? It takes a lot of maturity to get blessed with a lot of money. Okay? Let's keep going. But Job had it. And God had blessed them abundantly. Verse number 4. And his sons went and feasted in their houses, every one his day, and sent and called for their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. So it seems like he had a very happy family life. Seemed like the kids all got along, right? They were well-to-do, but I think the problem is they didn't look at God the same way Job did. You say, how do you know that? Well, I don't think they were very spiritual. They were blessed by what? Association. They were blessed by association. They had a wonderful life, but it was because their father was so godly, and because they were associated with him, the overflow of blessing touched their lives. Because look at verse 5. This gives us an indicator of where they were at, because Job knew where they at, and he did this. And it was so, when the days of their feasting were gone about, that Job sent and sanctified them, and rose up early in the morning. So it seems like they like to have parties. They like to live the good life. You know, they like to get out and throw, you know, big parties and invite a lot of people, and wine and song and good food, and party it up. Probably not thinking too much about what? God, or worshiping Him. And he rose up early in the morning, and he offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. So there's 10 of them, and so he's offering a burnt offering for what? Each one of the children. Each one of them by name. He offers up an offering and a sacrifice and prayers to God for each one of them. And I'm going to just say this. If you're a parent or a grandparent, I hope you're praying for your children and your grandchildren. I hope you never stop praying until the day you leave this world. And I hope you're trying to have an impact and an influence on them. And it's not always by preaching at them. We're not saying that. If God gives you the opportunity, certainly talk to them about the Lord. If they're saved, pray that they'll grow and get in a good Bible church and really serve the Lord and grow. If they're not saved, you better pray that God touches their heart and gets them saved and gets the gospel to them and convicts them of their sin. And don't feel bad. If your children are unsaved and they're going through suffering, don't feel bad for them. You say, but I can't help it. Of course, let me put it this way. I know you're going to feel bad. I would too. But don't let it overwhelm you. Be wise enough to realize God is allowing this suffering in their life to get their attention. If God just blessed them, they would forget about God like Job's children. And they'd never get saved. Better that they suffer now some heartache and realize they need Christ than have a wonderful life, die, and split hell wide open. So just let me just give that out to you, because I could preach a whole series on that. Look here, Job was concerned about his children. He offers a sacrifice for each one of them by name in prayers. And he says, because he said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job. Notice something? Was it just one time? He did it what?
Continually. This practice of offering sacrifices for... Now, do you ever think about what it would entail to slaughter 10 animals and then offer them up as a burnt sacrifice? You know the hours and hours and hours and hours it would take to do that? He could have been off partying with them or been on vacation enjoying the good life. You know what he said? I'm concerned for their souls. That's a challenge to us, folks. I have a son. There's not a day that goes by that I don't pray from morning to night for him. Okay? I hope you're doing the same. I hope you're praying for your children, for your grandchildren. If not, you better get started. If you don't, who's gonna? Who's gonna stand in the gap for them if you don't? One of the ways you can suffer for Christ is by suffering in prayer. Lewis Murray Schaefer wrote a book called True Evangelism. He said true evangelism begins not with speaking to people about God, but speaking to God about people. In other words, it begins by talking to God about men rather than talking to men about God. Don't worry, the time will come where God will open the door to talk to them. But the thing that Satan wants to stop is our what? Prayers of intercession. Especially for our loved ones that are not saved. Or our loved ones who may be saved, but they're straying. Job did it what? Continually. And he gave a great sacrifice of himself for those children. You think about what it would take to slaughter 10 animals and do that in one day. Okay? And sacrifice them. Then offer up the prayers for each one. Now look at verse number 6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. Wow, now something is interesting. The word sons of God in the Hebrew tongue, Benaha Elohim, and it's only used of angels. The sons of God here in the Old Testament, there's those who have tried to say these are believers. It is not. It is the angels. The sons of God are the angels, and the angels are in the presence of the Lord. And the scene here seems to be the courtroom of heaven. It's like a courtroom scene. The Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is there. The elect angels and some high-ranking fallen angels. And then Satan himself has access into the courtroom. Remember, Satan can only go into the courtroom of heaven until midpoint of what? The 70th week, when he's cast out. Revelation 12 tells us that, verses 7 to 10. But he goes there to accuse the brethren. And so now, the sons of God are gathered. It seems to be that from time to time in the conflict of the ages, there are special dates and times where the courtroom of heaven adjourns in Satan's appeal trial. And Satan is allowed to come in and bring what? Accusation. And God's allowed to present what? Witnesses. But he's not talking about Joe and Shirley, the average Christian. This courtroom drama is concerning people like Job and Moses and Paul and the apostles and Daniel and Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego, the saints at Smyrna, and godly men and women down through the ages who've reached that height of spiritual maturity and had an impact against Satan's kingdom. And God's there to present them as evidence, and Satan is there to cross-examine them. And to try to what? Destroy their... When you cross-examine... When the prosecution presents a witness in the trial against you, and you get a chance to cross-examine them, what are you trying to do? Discredit their testimony. In other words, if Satan, when God presents Job as evidence against Satan, if Satan can get Job to curse God, he discredits Job's what? Testimony. His evidence has to be thrown out. Job is not a reliable witness for God because when he suffered, he cursed God. So the purpose of Satan's cross-examination of Job, as we're going to see, is to discredit his testimony. In the courtroom where the drama's unfolding. The same with any Christian that God presents as a witness against Satan. Okay, we get the picture here. Let's read on, verse 7. And the Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou? And Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down it. And now we know that Satan is not in hell. He's never been there. He's never been. He will be in the lake of fire one day when Jesus returns after the 1,000-year reign. He'll be held in the abyss for 1,000 years. He'll be loosed for a little while. Then he'll be cast into the lake of fire one day with all those who have followed him, all the angels and demons and unbelieving humans that followed him. But right now, he has access to heaven, and he is free to roam to and fro about the earth. The Bible says he's like a roaring lion seeking whom he may what? Devour, kill and destroy. He cometh to rob and kill and destroy. So he's been going up and down on the earth, and he's been doing his homework. He's noticed Job. He didn't walk in here without the briefs in his hands. He's got the dossier on Job, and he knows Job has been blessed tremendously by God, and he's a spiritual man, a very highly spiritual man, whom God loves and cherishes. And he knows the Lord's going to present him. So he's already got his brief prepared, his argument prepared of how he's going to what? Try to slander Job and then get the opportunity to cross-examine and destroy and discredit his testimony for God. Wow. What a fantastic drama is unfolding. And you know, we would not know this unless it was recorded in the Bible. This is what goes on in the spiritual realm. It goes on still today. There are suffering saints of God today who are bearing witness against Satan in his appeal trial. And Satan is cross-examining them with intensive, undeserved suffering to try to destroy and discredit their testimony and get them to curse God. Many of these saints are sitting in prison cells in communist countries and Muslim countries, where just to mention the name of Jesus can cost you your life. And like I said Sunday, in America, you know, we've got little problems and we fall to pieces. Because our mindset is not right. And we need to grow and get that mindset right so that we can honor and glorify God. Look at verse number 8. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil. Like, this is the star witness for the prosecution. God's bragging on what? Job. You know, when you get up to bear witness in a courtroom, if you're a witness against the defense and if you're a witness for the prosecution, to establish your credibility, the prosecuting lawyer will ask a series of questions. How old are you? Where are you born? What's your marital status? What's your educational background? What kind of job do you perform? Are you a member of a church? Are you involved in any ministries helping people? And on and on and on. Why? Because trying to bring all the good things out about you to establish your what? Credibility and reliability as a witness, to establish your testimony against the one who's under prosecution. You see? And so God is doing this. God is bragging on who? Job. He's establishing Job's credibility. Do you see it? All right. And he's basically presenting Job as evidence against Satan. Here's a star witness. Now look at verse number 9. Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "Doth Job fear God for naught?" Yes, a sarcastic question. Basically, what he's attempting to do, he's responding to God by slander. He's going to try to slander Job to what? Discredit him as a witness. Keep reading verse 10. Hast not thou made an hedge about him? Didn't you build this hedge of protection around him so that I can't get through to him? And about his house and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. In other words, you protect him and you prosper him. You think he serves you for nothing? Look what you give him. Look what you do for him. Look how you take care of him. Look how you provide for him and protect him and prosper him with good things. Look at verse 11. But put forth thine hand now and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. Satan's argument is, hey, he doesn't worship you, serve you for nothing. You take it away from him, he'll curse you to your face. He wants to destroy the testimony of what? The witness. You see? Against himself. Satan slanders Job, and he's going to seek permission to cross-examine him. And this cross-examination would take place where? In time, on planet Earth. Job's not in the courtroom of heaven. He's on earth living his life. Job is not even cognizant right now that he is evidence against Satan. Job is loving God, serving God, and he's very concerned about his children. And yet he's blessed abundantly. He fears God. He turns from evil. He wants nothing to do with sin and evil and wickedness. He's upright and honest. The man of integrity. He's doing his best to trust God and serve God. He doesn't recognize that God has said, wow, behold my servant Job. You know, we studied a few weeks ago that the Lord, anyone that loves God, the Lord knows them. He knows all his children, right, as far as salvation. The Lord knoweth them that are his. But we looked and we studied very clearly. When you study, compare scripture with scripture, there's also a special knowing of God. God knows certain saints of God, certain believers that are special to him because they love him supremely and serve him sacrificially. And they understand what this life is about and why they're here and where they're going. And they're living not for today, but for eternity. And the Lord knows them in a special way. And he brings Job up here. And Satan wants Adam. Satan wants... Here's the thing. Satan just made some accusations. He only serves you because of what you what? Give him and bless him with. You take it away, he'll curse you to your face. Now, of course, the Lord could say, well, that just isn't so. Because God knows what? Everything. But being a just judge, he has to give Satan the opportunity to prove his accusation. You say, well, why does God... Listen, that's your problem. Listen. God shouldn't do that. Listen, you can ask why, but you don't have any right to say that God can't do what God decided he's going to do. God is sovereign. And God can do as he pleases. And I'm going to tell you what. Right now, Job is not upset that God allowed this in his life. And when the kingdom comes and Job is rewarded abundantly, fantastically, beyond even what you could imagine or think, he's not going to look back at this and say, you know, Lord, that wasn't fair that you allowed that to happen to me. He's going to say, thank you, Lord, for allowing it to happen, because look what I possess today. And this is not just temporal. That good life I had on earth with the money and the ranch and the children and all the goodness that was there, the flocks, that could only last, what, 80, 90, 100, 120 years maybe. And it's gone. It was temporal. But what I have now that is the result of going through that is eternal. It's forever. Thank you, Lord, for letting me be a witness for you. Even though it involved intense suffering. This is big boy and girl stuff right here. This is not for baby Christians. If you're a new believer or a young believer, or maybe you've been a believer a long time, but you haven't grown, all right, just relax. Don't choke on this. Start growing. And you may never qualify for this, but maybe you'll qualify for some testing that'll bring you a reward someday if you learn how to handle it. Now look here at verse number 12. So Satan is going to get permission to cross-examine the witness so that he can prove that his slander and his accusation that he brought out to discredit Job's testimony is true. You see? That's what this is about. Look at verse 12. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power, under your authority. Now notice, the first thing we want to note is the sovereignty of God here, right? The sovereignty of God. Remember we studied that way back when we studied the character of God? And God's sovereignty means he's the boss, he makes the rules, we answer to him, he doesn't answer to us. He can do as he pleases with his creation. And the sovereignty of God also means this, that nothing can happen in our lives unless it passes through his permissive what? Will. Nothing can happen to us unless he allows it. God had put a hedge of protection around his child Job, his servant Job. And Satan could not penetrate that hedge unless God allowed it. You understand? And here God allows it. And we need to take something from this. Our God is sovereign. You know, the sovereignty of God, when you understand it, first of all, it's not God making all the decisions for everybody. We have choices that we make, but God's made many decisions without asking us our what? Opinion. But he does give us a measure of freedom to make choices in our life. And then he makes some choices without asking us what we think about it, what our opinion is. And that's the test. Will we humble ourselves and say, even so, Father, for it seemeth good in thy sight, and accept his sovereign will and sovereign wisdom and sovereign decisions in our life? Because he's God, and he's the boss. We answer to him, he doesn't answer to us, whether we like it or not. And the realization that, listen, I'm not going to go through anything unless God allows it. And if he allows it, it's necessary. Remember last week? If need be for a season. If it's necessary for your spiritual growth and continued what? Advance to bear fruit and reward and blessing. If it's necessary for a season, you go through the heaviness. But when he comes, if you trust him, it'll be found to praise and glory and honor your faith. When he returns, he'll reward you for trusting him in that time, that season. Now look here. It couldn't happen unless God what? Allowed it. Satan's got to get permission. But if God has to allow it, it's a very comforting thing, because it says that there's a purpose in it. It's not just mere chance or arbitrary caprice of some tyrant playing games with us in our lives.
There's a purpose. There's a real reason for it. It's for our spiritual growth. We studied that Sunday. It's designed to do something in us and change us and teach us to trust and give us an opportunity to be rewarded and blessed and grow. And with that, we also know if God allowed it, means he's in what? Control. He'll not allow you to be tested above that which you are what? Able. Right? But will also with it make a way of what? Escape. That you might be able to what? Bear it. 1 Corinthians 10:13. You ought to put that one down. That's one you got. That's a keeper. That's one of my go-to verses. And Romans 8:28 is great, but I like 1 Corinthians 10:13. Hebrews 13:5 too. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. The Lord is my helper. I'll not fear what man will do to me. Those are keepers. Right? You got to keep them here, right? But here's the thing. If he allowed it, he's in control. That means he's got a plan and there's a way out of this. God controls when the testing begins. God controls when the testing is going to what? End. God controls everything in between. So I can have a peace because my Father in heaven, who loves me, who is on my side, since God before me, who can be what? Against me. Who's promised never to leave me nor forsake me and work all things out for good in my life and provide all my needs. He's in control. This thing that happened might have shocked me and hit me and tossed me and threw me for a loop. Hopefully I've regrouped and realized, wait a minute though. Now that I got the initial shockwave over with, let's approach this from God's perspective like a Christian who knows the Word of God and is growing and is positive and wants to honor God. My Father allowed it. He's in control. I'm not here alone. He's with me. He will give me everything I need to handle it if I trust him. And he's going to make a way what? Out of it in his time, in his way. I'm going to start to praise him right now. I don't see the deliverance yet, but it's coming. Oh, you know, we can all praise him when we get through it and it's behind us. That's easy to praise him then, right? And we should. Nothing wrong with that, right? God takes you through something hard and you get through and you're on the other side and you're being blessed and you're thankful. Of course you praise him, right? But that's easy. The test is, can you praise him in the midst of it? Is he still God? Is his promises still true in the midst of it when you're still going through it? Can you rejoice in the Lord always? And again, I say, rejoice. You know, folks, this is a challenge to grow up. This is big boy, big girl stuff. But this is what God wants from us. And here, Satan is getting permission to attack and cross-examine Job. Let's move on for a little bit more, see what we can finish with tonight, and we'll pick up with the rest of this on next Wednesday service. And it says, God says, listen, you can, everything he has is under your authority, but you can't touch his body. He says, only upon himself put not forth thy hand. In other words, Satan, your hand can touch everything he owns, everything that he possesses, everything that he holds dear, but you cannot afflict his physical what? Body. Yet. Because we'll see that that's going to change later. I look at the rest of the verse 12. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. Satan had gotten what? Permission. Right? As his own defense attorney. Satanus. Satan, the adversary, the accuser, had gotten permission, and now he left the courtroom of heaven, and he descended back down through the heavens to planet Earth to roam to and fro and seek out who? Job. To destroy his testimony, to discredit his character, to ruin him as a witness that's reliable against who? Satan himself. And look at verse number 13. And there was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. They like to party, these kids. Dad was godly. Dad worked hard. Dad was very wealthy and blessed. The kids were nothing but a bunch of spoiled brats. It appears. Notice it doesn't say that they were out worshiping the Lord or serving the Lord, but it mentions quite a few times that they were what? Drinking wine and feasting and partying. And recognized all this that we're enjoying comes from our what? Association with Dad and the God that Dad what? Serves and loves. We go on, and it says in verse 14, and there came a messenger unto Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the asses feeding beside them while Satan has begun his what? Attacks. He's begun his cross-examination. The oxen were plowing, the asses feeding beside them, and the Sabians, these are the marauding bandits that lived at that time and raided the different villages and towns. The Sabians, they were bandits. And they fell upon them. They were gangsters, thieves, murderers, and took them away, and they have slain the servants with the edge of the sword. These are Job's servants. Not only did he have 10 children, he had the number of servants is not named, but I'm assuming quite a few. When you consider the flock, he probably had hundreds of servants. He needed them to take care of all these what? Flocks that he had, the oxen and the camels, and 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 oxen, 500 donkeys, and a big house that he had to take care of, all the ranch, the fields, the grain, hundreds of servants. It doesn't tell us exactly how many. It says they slain the servants with the edge of the sword. They raided his property, okay, while they were at work, and they killed him. And I only am escaped alone to tell thee. Then we move on, verse 16. While he was yet speaking, now the first servant arrives and is yet speaking and telling of this terrible calamity that has taken place. And while he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the fire of God has fallen from heaven and had burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them. And I only am escaped alone to tell thee. He calls it the fire of God. He didn't understand it was from what? Satan? Okay? Called it the fire of God. He didn't understand it was from Satan. He didn't understand that this is Satan's cross-examination. It's an attack against Job of tremendous, intense, undeserved suffering. And then verse 17, while he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the Chaldeans made out three bands and fell upon the camels and have carried them away, yea, and slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee. So in succession, this bad news keeps coming. Your business was burned to the ground. All your servants were killed by thieves and murderers as they looted the business after it burned. All your cash and the mutual funds and retirement, stock market and investments, it's lost. The market crashed. It's gone. Your house was destroyed and flattened. Keep reading. Verse 18, while he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, thy sons and daughters and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. Now it gets closer to home, his children. And behold, there came a great wind. There was a tornado from the wilderness, and it smote the four corners of the house. It knocked the house down while they were feasting and partying and drinking wine and carrying on with frivolity and levity. Disaster struck, which they were totally unprepared to handle.
And the tornado came and it knocked down the house and it fell upon the young men and they are dead. And I only am escaped alone to tell thee. Now, here's the thing. It does seem from the passage that the daughters lived. It says the young men died when the house crashed. So the seven sons die, but the three daughters what? Escape. And we got to look here and we see that it says, I only am escaped. And we got to realize, well, there's other servants that what? Lived. The majority of them were killed. But you know what happens? What happened was so horrible and so traumatizing that these servants, as they came, they just went through an emotional roller coaster that ripped them apart internally. Their nervous system was what? Under siege. And they were terrified emotionally and so traumatized that they're not reasoning properly, and because of that, they do what we do. They exaggerate things, right? Well, things were pretty bad, but they exaggerated even more. I'm the only one that made it. No other ones survived, but it was bad. It was horrible. It was horrific. We're not making light of that, but you know, when we go through things, we know how that feels when we really get traumatized. We kind of act like everything is 1,000 times worse than it really was. Well, this was pretty bad. I don't know how much it could get worse. And then verse 20, and we'll close here with these last few verses. Then Job arose, and he rent his mantle, ripped his clothes, and he shaved his head, and he fell down upon the ground. Now, what he did here is what was known and used in as an act that was performed in the Near East when you were mourning, when you were grieving. Okay, today, you know, you'd put a black suit on and be somber and go to a funeral, right? But Job, he shaves his head, he rips his clothing, he falls down to the ground. He's mourning the loss of all his property, all his wealth, his servants, everything he worked for his whole life and built, it's gone in a few hours. Totally unexpectedly, totally undeserved, a bolt from the blue, Satan's vicious attack upon this godly man who did not deserve it. And then it says something that we ought to take note of. He rent his mantle, he shaved his head, he fell down upon the ground, and then what did he do? And he worshiped. He worshiped. He worshiped God. It's easy to worship God when everything's going well. It's easy to worship him when he's blessing you. It's so easy to praise him when everything's going good, when things are working out the way you want, and life is good. But the true test of where you are at spiritually and how far you have matured is how do you handle undeserved suffering? How do you handle undeserved suffering? Do you still worship God? Well, can't we grieve? Sure you can grieve. Job grieved. Nothing wrong with grieving. Nobody's saying that you can't grieve. But notice something. The grief was not so great that it stopped him from what? Praising and worshiping and serving who? God. And Satan's got the number on a lot of Christians. Some of us, all he's got to do is throw a little something at us. He's got the dossier, he's got the file, he knows the weakness. Just throw a little something at us, and all of a sudden what? Our whole countenance changes. We get down in the dumps. We get depressed, discouraged, worried, fearful, sad. And we can barely open our mouth. And our joy is what? Taken.
But David said in the Psalms, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Let me tell you something. He worshiped, and look what he said. Look at the statement. And he said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. And here you can, I could just see Satan leaning over with the band of his table of organization, the powers of darkness and principalities of spiritual wickedness in high places, watching earnestly and eagerly and just waiting for him to curse God. Curse him! He was sure that he had discredited him now. He was sure that he now would establish that his accusation against Job was true. And with delight and anticipation, Satan watched eagerly with his comrades behind him. But he was very disappointed on that day. Because here's a man that knew that we worship God not because of what he gives us or how he blesses us, but we owe him our worship because of who he is. And we answer to him. He does not answer to us. Naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord taken away. In other words, it's his sovereign right. Right, he's a humble man saying, God is sovereign. He can do as he pleases. I bow before him. He doesn't answer to me. And I accept his will, because he doeth all things well. And he said, blessed be the name of the Lord. And in all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. And Satan's accusation was defeated. Do you see it? Here's the thing, folks. Now, you and I may never ever get to the place where we become evidence against Satan like Job. But we certainly can honor God and glorify God in our life. And hey, maybe we will grow to that point someday where we can be evidence against Satan. But the thing we all can do is grow and serve him. And when we're attacked with undeserved suffering and things don't go our way and life is hard, we're not going to throw in the towel. We're not going to give in to the pity party. We're not going to say, woe is me. We're not going to let everybody see how down we are. We're going to lift up the name of Jesus anyway. We ought to praise him anyway. Let me say something. Did Jesus save you? Are your sins forgiven? Are you going to heaven by his grace? If he never did another thing for you, you got reason to praise and worship him every minute of every day until he takes you home to heaven or he returns. I used to like what the old Pentecostal preacher on the radio used to say. I liked him because he shouted a lot. And he used the King James Bible. But he used to say, if God never did anything else but save you, you ought to shout hallelujah every day, because everything else is just icing on the cake. I don't care how bad it gets. I don't care if all your money's lost and your house is destroyed in a tornado, and God, I hope it never happens, but and you lose the loved ones dear to you, you still can praise God because he's worthy. Let me tell you, just because of who he is. And let me tell you something else. Because he saved you. He loved you enough to send his son to die on that cross. Isn't it terrible how we treat our Father in heaven sometimes? When problems come, we get all upset. We're all guilty of it, right? Every one of us. We get anxious. We lose sight of everything He promised us. We lose sight of everything He's done for us. We lose sight of the fact that our sins are washed away by the blood. And we're going to spend eternity with Him. We fail to praise Him. And yet the Bible tells us in Isaiah, we'll look at this next week, one of the ways that you get rid of the depression, and the world has got so many schemes for this, but the Bible's got one. Lift the shield of faith and lift the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. That's the Bible, folks. That's God's way. Lift the shield of faith. Believe what God told you, that He's going to get you through, that He's going to take care of you, that He's going to work it for good. And then begin to praise Him for that. Say, what could I praise Him for? Praise Him that He washed your sins away and you're going to heaven. What else could I praise Him for? Praise Him that He promised never to leave you. What else could I praise Him for? Praise Him that you're still breathing today. What else could I praise Him for? Praise Him for 100 promises of the Bible that says He'll provide for you, take care of you, work all things out for good, deliver you, make a way of escape. Praise Him. Let's do this. Here's the challenge. This week, when you are faced with disappointments and struggles and challenges, rather than giving in to depression and discouragement and fear, why not stand up and say no? My God is worthy. And He is with me, and He has forgiven me, and He's promised to never leave me and take care of me. I'm going to praise His name, even though it's not going the way I want. I will not give in to discouragement and fear and anger and resentment and depression. I will praise His name. And you know what? If you start praising Him, you say, I don't know, that's kind of hard for me. I don't really do that. Well, you ought to start. You ain't going to enjoy heaven too much if you don't like praising the Lord. Well, how do I go about it? Why don't you just get some good Christian music? Get some praise music. Put it on. Just start singing along and worshiping God. Let me tell you something. It does change your countenance. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's praise Him, folks, all right? Let's bow our head for prayer. Father, tonight we're so grateful, so thankful to have had this time to note these things, Lord. And I pray that You challenge our hearts, Lord, to just be able to respond to the adversity in our lives by worshiping You and praising You and not allowing it to overwhelm us, Lord, but to use it to glorify You by giving You worship and praise, even in the midst of the hard times. And I pray, Lord, that You would grant us this grace. Each one of Your children here tonight, and each one that listens to this message, Lord. And if anyone is unsaved, Lord, that within the sound of my voice, my prayers, that You touch their hearts. And right now, if you're not saved, you can tell God, I know that I'm a sinner. But I do believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, who died for my sins and rose again. And Lord Jesus, I'm trusting You and You alone as my Savior, my Lord. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. We'll take a moment of silent prayer for anyone who wishes to believe upon the Lord Jesus. Now, Father, tonight, if your Holy Spirit has spoken to anyone's heart, they have believed upon the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, my prayer is that you would give them assurance that you have forgiven them and saved them. I pray, Father, that you would reveal your love to them in a special way and lead them back to study your word, that they might grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And as we depart tonight, I pray that you take the written word, make the living word, the Lord Jesus Christ, real to our hearts and minds. And I ask these things in his precious name. Amen and amen. Hey, folks, it's been a pleasure. Have a great night. Hope to see you Sunday morning. If you can make it, there's prayer meeting tomorrow night.